I don't know what it was. He's walking upright like a man.
Sightings in and around Vermont.
Bigfoot sightings across New England have been reported.
Red glowing eyes, about 7 feet tall.
Red eyes, big old fangs, claws coming out through. 3 inches long, you know, just sharp as they can be.
There has been another UFO sighting flying over the Royal Botanic Gardens. There are 500 UFO sightings in the world every month. The truth is out there.
It's St. Patrick's Day.
Blarney.
So you know what that means. It's the first day of the Grand Sumo Tournament, so we're going to root for all our battle boys. It really is too, by the way. I was watching that this morning.
Of course you were.
Yeah, which I won't go into.
It's next week. It's the end of this week. It's Friday. Okay.
Oh, St. Patrick's Day. When they're doing the parade and stuff around here. Something I want to talk about because it was epic, but I'll make brief because it's boring, is an office prank that I did. So it's first off, like, we deal with a lot of like people who you have to be very professional with customer wise.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Two weeks ago, we have a coworker, an engineer whose last name sounds kind of like Mark Wahlberg's last name. So people call him Narc Wahlberg because he also looks like a cop.
Narc.
So 2 weeks ago, I made an offhand comment to another guy that knows him. It'd be funny if you change his email signature so that his last name was Wahlbergsky. And because that's something you might not notice. And then what I did Friday is I took from my inbox and modified an existing email signature and took a screenshot and sent it to that individual and said, hey, I did this Tuesday. So now this person thinks for a week that he's been sending emails to clients with that as his email signature. And he bought it because I planted that there's a, it took me a month to get to the point to send that picture. So, cause I let it like stew and that's the convincer.
Oh my God. God damn it, Brandon.
So he believed it. And then I went to this person who we were joking about changing their email signature to. And I was like, hey, listen, here's a thing I did. This person bought it. So here's a gift I'm giving to you. You can now do whatever you want with this knowledge. You could like just start talking about different customers you've been emailing. And so he starts walking around and talking, and it's the rescue squad is out of where I work. He was laughing so hard and trying not to laugh that an EMT ran over to his desk because he thought he was crying. Because it was the, like, I have to hold it in, kind of. It was fantastic.
And wait, why did the EMT run over because he was crying?
Yeah, well, it sounded like if you looked over, he was face in his hands huddled over his desk and trying to hold in the laughter. Because he believed he was emailing, like, major, like, government contractors with, like...
So
you just heard... Because it was the kind of, like, when he has to hold it in. Then the guy who I told that said, here's this information as a gift. And so he was like, he said, I emailed such and such at such company. And then I knew everyone that this guy had shared that information with because they all stood up from their desks and made like wide-eyed faces like, oh, shit. So anyway, that's the end of the story. It's office prank. So I'll keep it brief.
God damn it. I feel like I don't have any good office prank stories. IBM was just sadness.
Office stuff be sad. I did go to Chuck E. Cheese for the first time in my life, and I can't wait to never do that again.
You've never been to Chuck E. Cheese before?
No. And I thought they had like robot bands.
They used to. Charles Entertainment Cheese did at one point have robot bands.
Now it's just like a big screen and they show videos. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it's basically Kids Bop, but doing Chuck E. Cheese songs.
Awful. So it's here's my question.
Horrifying.
For you.
Yeah.
Did you go to the one in Poughkeepsie?
That one, yes.
Okay. Cool.
God, I can't. That's the first and last time I'm ever doing anything like that.
My favorite, like, my favorite thing to say back in grad school was, like, we legally can't go into Chuck E. Cheese or something along those lines. Because one of the people would joke about going to Chuck E. Cheese, right?
Uh-huh.
And I'm just like, no, no, we fucking can't. That fucking a bunch of dudes in their 20s walking into Charles Entertainment Cheese.
That's
no.
I had
with
a baby
no child.
With me. Yeah, you can't do it with no kid.
If you don't have a kid and you walk into Chuck E. Cheese, you are a sus human being.
It's
full stop.
Even if you go in with a kid, like, that was basically, if you customized a hell specifically for me, that's what it, my daughter had a blast. So that's the good part. It was adorable. But just, I don't know what the heat was on. It's hot. It's just so hot. And then you're like, oh God, like, I have to avoid everybody. And then you look at the where the servers are, there's beer on the menu. So then you go up, and you're like, I need beer because I can't be, even if I'm not interacting with or near them, this is just too many kids for me to like observe. And it turns out they don't have their liquor license.
What?
So they have beer on the menu, but they can't sell it to you.
Well, I think that might be a problem with that particular Chuck E. Cheese.
It is specific to that one.
That was like a part of its original design, if my memory is correct. So, Borland, the dude who's responsible for the Atari 2600, right? Borland.
Yes.
I forgot this connection.
Yes.
Yeah.
I forgot about
that. And the original Chuck E. Cheese had like a room for parents to go into.
Yeah.
And like they could watch sports and drink alcohol and stuff like that. Cause that was like, that was the like whole appeal of it.
I wish that's what it was. Like, there's a room where you can just hang out and a room where you can just like let your kid wreak havoc, not at home, and then just go home and they take a nap. That sounds amazing. That's not what this is.
No, Chuck E. Cheese, all, from my memory,
it's supposed
is
to be. It's supposed to be separated into like one side for big kids and one side for little kids, but it's just fucking chaos.
If my memory is correct, so is that Chuck E. Cheese still laid out the same way? There's like a death corridor where like you have to walk down to get to talk to a person who, like, you pay money or they take you somewhere because it's to keep the children from running away, right? So they have this corridor that's like a good solid 15 feet to the door, just so if they get any runners, they can catch them.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like plexiglass, like a 15-foot long just hallway straight down the center of like waist-high plexiglass that goes to like a lady at a booth with like locked plexiglass doors. And it's basically like, if you're playing a tower defense game, it's like the perfect to just mow everyone down.
It's like the kill point, like the choke point.
Yeah, so you walk your kid down the murder hallway, and then you go in. They like stamp your hand with a number with ultraviolet ink, which,
yeah, it's for you and your kids, so you can like,
oh, is it for you and your kid? I thought it was like they had like fire code violations or something and they had to like start
No, it's like a match you up system, right?
So like an anti-kidnapping. Now that you say that makes sense, and I appreciate it.
Yeah, no, it makes sense. It's not dumb. Like, what they did is not stupid. But also, it's hilarious in hindsight.
Yeah, it's, oh, God.
They had a really cool Star Wars arcade cabinet there for a while.
I don't know if it's still there. We stayed on, like, the little kid's side, so she played, like, a SpongeBob arcade machine where you like a button lights up, you hit the button, and then you like punch Squidward in the face.
Oh no!
So she did that.
Poor Squidward.
Her favorite thing is they had a big old floor mat, Squidward, where it's an LED light up floor mat, like the dance floor, and like Chuck E. Cheese heads float around on it. And if you step on them, they run away from you. So it was mostly just her just running and stomping on a mouse for like an hour.
Okay, so that's 100% designed just to wear kids down.
Dude, she had fun. Oh no. Oh no, technical issues. But this time we didn't lose an episode, so I'll call that a win-win.
Yeah, no, that's fair. That's fair. Yeah, let's with, keep that.
Yeah. With that being said, welcome to Cryptopedia, an exploration of the myths and legends that haunt the human mind, where each week we will take you on a journey exploring the mysteries of the world, tackling tales of monsters, folklore, the paranormal, and that thing that definitely lives under your bed. I'm Brandon.
I'm John, and it's the animatronic Chuck E. Cheese from the 90s that lives under your bed, so have fun with that.
It is. It's, I think you can still find those in like scrap yards and stuff. Today we're going to cover the Falkville Metal Man. I have several sources, including a hard copy of the 1974 book Beyond Earth, Man's Contact with UFOs, because I couldn't find a copy online, as well as some news articles. For this particular case, the authors are drawing from newspapers at the time, as well as people who interviewed locals and passed the information on to Ralph and Judy Bloom, who were the authors of aforementioned book.
Okay. So Beyond Earth, yeah. Man's Contact with UFOs.
Yes.
Okay.
So our case takes place in Falkville, Alabama, about 24 miles south of Huntsville, in the northern quarter of the state. In 1970, if I read the census correctly, at the time had a population of 946 people.
Jesus
so we're
Christ.
Talking about some small town shenanigans.
That's small town to a new level, to be totally honest.
It occupies a large portion of the map, so I imagine it's pretty spread out.
Is that like white, that whole white like thing that, or is that like the county or the district? Because if that was the whole thing, that would be hilarious.
That I'm
assuming
wrote this
it's,
episode a long time
I'm
ago.
I'm assuming that's the
that's
district.
The county, I believe. Yeah. But that's the area we're talking
that
about.
That would be hilarious if that was the whole like town.
If that's all of Falkville, that would be wild.
We don't go to Falkville.
The night of the event was Wednesday, October 17th on 1973. Historical weather data shows that the high of the day was 70 degrees Fahrenheit and the low was 41.9 degrees Fahrenheit, measured 2 meters from the ground.
Now that's a very specific metric. Was that in the book or did you just like look that up?
I looked that up. So this is a UFO-y thing.
Yeah.
And whenever people describe like the time, people are going to talk about the day when it happened. So to make sure or to compare their descriptions of the day.
Mm-hmm.
To see how accurate it was.
Yeah.
Airports publish very specific weather data. So that is historical weather data that was recorded by the nearest airport during the exact time that the events happened.
Interesting. Okay. So yeah,
that's, I think I have a couple episodes in the pipeline where like people spoke about weather or the day or whether it was cloudy. So I like took the historical data from the airport to be able to compare their story to see if they're like fluffing it a bit
or forgetting.
Or forgetting.
Like, yeah. Cause we can't forget that like a lot of people saying things wrong isn't even malice. It's just the human brain doesn't work good.
Brain don't work good. Brain work for survive. Mm-hmm. Brain don't work for anything else.
Yeah, and if you have anxiety, your brain works too well for survival.
Yeah. I'm going to survive so hard, I'm going to make it hard for you to do things.
Well, it's just because it's hard for you to do things in modern society. Your brain is great for, like, get me the fuck away from that tiger.
There's, you know, that's fair. I have... None of my family members have been attacked by a tiger, mm-hmm. So I presume that their brains are working perfectly.
Yep, that's as designed. Well, not designed, but, you know.
The event occurred around 10 p.m. The weather data showing it was mostly cloudy, but cleared up by 10:30 to clear skies. the moon was a waning gibbous, the first phase of a full moon. And this data is taken from the Decatur Airport, 20 miles north of Falkville.
That's actually pretty close if we're talking like middle of nowhere statistics and like distances. Like that's actually like really close in terms of like weather data and stuff along those lines.
Yeah, which is why I included it. It was close enough where like you could trust that data would influence that area.
Yeah.
I've got another one south of the equator where the nearest airport was actually pretty far away, so I wasn't able to really rely on that weather data as significantly as we could rely on this.
Yeah.
But also weatherspark.com. Thank you. That lots of historical weather data if you need that for some reason.
I want to there's a part of me that wants to like interview a bunch of people or like do a poll, like how far do you think 20 miles is, right? Like in terms of like,
yeah,
is that a long distance to travel? Is that blah 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 blah? Like, because everything, you'll know so much about the people who you're talking to by asking that question. Yeah.
So Falkville appears to be a rural country town. From pictures I see online, almost like there could be a shootout at high noon in some of the pictures. And I included a picture here.
Yeah, that's... I see... So if I'm looking at this picture correctly, I see a train track in front of a bunch of, like, square, kind of boring-looking buildings.
Yeah, it's a train track in what looks like a bunch of colorized saloons.
Yeah, pretty much. It looks like it looks like they only have one industry in Falkville, and that is alcohol.
That's probable.
I mean, I mean, I know enough about like rural America and like all of that that like alcohol is pretty much the main hobby of most places.
It looks, actually, you know, thinking about it, it looks like North Front Street. So it looks like,
oh yeah,
like a city block, but there's only one side of the street and the other side is just a train track and then countryside.
It looks like someone took a piece of like a city downtown and then just found a like empty field in the middle of nowhere, plopped it down and made a road to it.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm writing this before reading the articles about this event in order to give both you and the cared listener and myself context for the weather during the event. Given that this is a UFO, I expect there's a high potential for reports of the craft in the skies, at least, and the sighting of the creature. And this is something I'm going to continue to do for UFO stuff, is I'm going to include historical weather data before reading anything about it, just so we have context prior to getting into it.
No, that's fair.
The first article I present is titled, Falkville Chief Says Howdy to Spaceman from Birmingham News, published October 17th, 1973, and is from the 1974 book that I purchased. What? So this is all... The book came out right after the event, so this is all very close.
Howdy, howdy, howdy. Why... It's 74. Okay. Let me throw myself back in time. It's 74. Lead still in the air.
Yep.
Right. There's just a serial killer epidemic that's like sweeping the nation. What else? Really like disgusting looking colors for everything. Okay,
let's see. I just googled what happened in 1973. Vietnam things.
Yep.
The OPEC oil embargo, Roe versus Wade, the Alaska oil pipeline, Wounded Knee, USA Sears. Actually, there was a lot going on in 1973.
Jesus fucking Christ.
And also aliens, I guess.
Yeah, apparently. Just to add a little bit of fuel to the fire, so to speak. Did Billy Joel start the fire yet? Or is that an 80s song?
It's Billy Joel. It's just Billy Joel. That's it. That's Billy Joel, descending Billy.
He's the one who crashed a bunch, right? If my memory is correct.
His like a car?
Yeah, didn't was it Billy Joel who crashed a bunch? The Piano Man, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, Piano Man was Elton John.
Well,
who, by the way, just declined to perform at the King's inauguration or whatever. So, hell yeah, Elton John.
Well, I mean, Elton John is kind of like Uncle. Wow,
Uncle John.
Uncle John. No, that's me. No, but the Elton John is like kind of a legend, a little bit.
He's a legend, and I love. So there's videos when you tour a lot. You don't use like the sound people at the theater. You have your own people that travel with you for like years and years, so you know them. So there's videos online of like Elton John having an audio issue and just like losing his shit on just some guy, but they've known each other forever, so that's just how he gets with them. But there's like Elton John in like the middle of like the biggest theater you could imagine, like stopping Piano Man and being like, Jesus Christ, Bill. He's like, I need more monitor. It's the best.
Amazing. Oh God. So Piano Man is the song that Billy Joel sang, right? That was what I was thinking of.
I thought Piano Man was the song that... Oh, no, you're right. Piano Man is Billy Joel. I'm getting my old artist mixed up. Anywho, so the fire chief's... Or the article continues, says... What do you say to a creature from outer space? Howdy, stranger, was the apt greeting from Falkville Police Chief Jeg Greenhaw.
Okay, there's like six things in there that I need to talk about. First of all, howdy, stranger. Brandon, that's on the level of you in a D&D campaign saying hail and well met.
That's very, very NPC behavior.
Right?
That is what you say if your name is Jeg.
Well, okay, that's the second thing. Jeg?
Yeah. Now, I don't know if that's a nickname, but I don't know what it could be a nickname like, for
what,
either.
What is the only thing I can think of is like jeggings, like jean leggings.
You know, it's he brought jeggings to Falkville. It's what he does. He's the jeggings. It's like Reno 911 over there.
It's
actually for the rest of this article, think Reno 911 because that's not far off.
Oh God. Okay. Wait. Apparently Jeg is a name.
Let's see.
I think I read Canada. One second. I'm trying to record your pronunciation of Jeg.
Is it Jeg?
Oh, that would be funny. What the fuck? Where did it? Pronunciation, Oregon.
Actually,
Jeg in numerology is was... two.
Ah, okay. Well, he's number one because he's the chief. Number one, Jeg. He's the number one, number two.
Ancestry.com, Jeg. Come on. Ancestry.com, come pull through for me. I want to know. Britain and Ireland. Historically, surnames evolved as a way to sort people into groups by occupation, place of origin, clan affiliation, blah, 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 blah. Oh, that's basically useless.
So, historically, his family made jeggings.
Yes.
Which is how he got that last name.
Long story short, his family made jeggings. That's how he got the name Jeg. But also Greenhaw. I don't know.
Yeah.
Everything about this man sounds fake. Like, it sounds like...
It sounds like
something...
This whole thing is Reno 911. Everything. Not just this article. The whole story. So, like, put yourself in that mindset, and then it makes sense.
Oh, no.
You're
the
dealing
poor cat.
With, like... This is... If It's Always Sunny was in the South... That's it, and then everything falls in line.
I feel like if Always Sunny was in the South and like I can't help but feel like if Always Sunny was in the South, it would somehow be worse. Like not worse as in like quality, but worse as in like Jesus fucking Christ, you monsters. And like they're already pretty Jesus fucking Christ, you monsters on that show. But like I have this feeling that that would be like a bridge too far.
Maybe. Although they had that, oh, I won't even talk about that episode. So Greenhall was at home when a woman telephoned him that a spaceship was flashing with flashing lights had landed in a field west of the city.
In a field west
also,
of the city.
Also, this is a town,
or as we call it,
where you call
the city.
Yeah, this is also a town. Like when you call 911, it just goes to his house.
Is
like because he was at home when he got
is
there.
Is it real? Jesus fuck. No, you know what? Actually, she probably didn't call 911. She probably called his number.
Oh, knew him. Oh.
Like, let's be real. Everyone probably has everyone else's number. Like, small towns can get super fucking incestuous, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. There's a few places, companies where I buy stuff from where, like, I don't call the company. I call directly to the person I want to talk to because I got their number and I can't. I hate fucking phone systems. Anyway, there had been numerous reports of USOs in South Morgan County. So Greenhaw grabbed his camera and drove to the remote area. After several turns down a gravel road, he quote, "I saw it. It was just standing there in the middle of the road," the police chief said. The police chief got his camera as the human-shaped creature walked towards him. He flashed photographs.
Oh, God.
I was scared. Oh, God.
Oh, I remember parts of the story now.
Oh, you know about this a little bit?
I know about the pictures.
Okay. I was scared stiff, Greenhaw admitted. The creature was covered in a tinfoil-type material, had a short antenna on top its head, covering... And there was no features on
its
face.
Yes, tinfoil-like. Not, it's absolutely tinfoil.
Oh, I did some detective work. It moved stiffly like a robot and didn't make any sounds, Greenhall said. The police chief decided to switch on his blue revolving flashlight atop his police patrol car, and immediately the creature turned around and started running towards the road. I jumped into my car and took after him. He said,
it moved stiffly like a robot, and then it just started fucking booking it.
This thing is so fast. It's so fast. He says, I couldn't even catch up with him in a patrol car.
What the fuck?
He was running faster than any human I ever saw, the police officer said.
What?
So this thing is... This is, what's that Godzilla movie?
Oh,
with the,
Godzilla versus Mechagodzilla 2 from the 90s. It's the Terminator ripoff.
Yeah. Yes. That picture of that.
I love the Heisei-era Godzilla movies because each of them kind of like has a nod. Like there's a very major story plot point that is like a nod to some other like early 90s, 80s. Sci-fi thing, right? So, if my memory is correct, Mechagodzilla 2 had the Terminator thing, but I think Godzilla versus Destoroyah, that one had like a had like an alien like inspired scene.
It did. I think Heisei was that the one. You have way more Godzilla stuff than I do. I don't know where they went, but I think Heisei was like the one where it had almost all of them on DVD, except for like two.
Heisei has, I think, six films. I'm going to look this up. There's Return of Godzilla, Godzilla versus Biollante. Then after Godzilla versus Biollante, it's, let's see, I think it's Mechagodzilla. No, it's before that. It's Space Godzilla. Godzilla versus Space Godzilla. Godzilla versus Mechagodzilla 2. Godzilla versus King Ghidorah. And then I think it's Destoroyah. So that's six, right? I think.
Yes.
So those movies are some of the... Honestly, in my personal opinion, they're
the best ones.
But... you know.
Yeah. So Greenhaw, Falkville's only full-time policeman,
of course,
said he received numerous telephone calls Thursday from people who said they spotted UFOs in the area about 10 p.m. Wednesday. His wife, Pamela, nice job naming her, by the way, left it off.
I got that order completely fucking wrong, and I dropped Godzilla vs. Mothra. It was seven films. Return of Godzilla, Godzilla vs. Biollante, Godzilla vs. King Ghidorah, Godzilla vs. Mothra, Godzilla vs. Mechagodzilla 2, Godzilla vs. Space Godzilla, and Godzilla vs. Destoroyah. My problem is I switched Moguera and Mechagodzilla, because, like, Mechagodzilla comes before Moguera,
gotcha.
And that totally fucked up my entire, like, timeline. Anywho, back to Pamela.
Yeah, I think the only ones that I didn't have was Return of Godzilla and Godzilla. I had Destroyer. So maybe I had all of them but one.
They're well, Return of Godzilla still has There's a history behind Godzilla 1985. I have a copy of the first Godzilla 1985.
Okay.
But, okay. So yeah. Basically what happened was the company, so it looks like StarMaker, Anchor Bay Entertainment owned the rights to Godzilla 1985, and they went under, and nobody knows where it basically fucking went from there. I was in the middle of watching this the last time. Anywho, so for like years they couldn't release the English release until eventually they were just like, fuck it, we're not going to release the one that has like Raymond Burr in it. We're just going to do the international release. So you can't get Godzilla 1985, the American cut of Godzilla, on DVD or Blu-ray because nobody knows who owns the fucking license.
Okay, so that makes sense why I don't have it. Look at that.
They did release it. Kraken released it. They got a hold of the license. They released that, Son of Godzilla, and Godzilla versus Ghidorah, if my memory is correct. Oh, and Godzilla versus the Sea Monster, which is my personal favorite Showa era film. So,
hey, cool. All right, I don't know if I saw that one. She wouldn't be laughing if she saw it. She wouldn't be laughing if she saw what I saw, Greenhoff said. Okay. And below are the pictures that were included in the
book. I need
book
to take
that
a second
took
to describe these pictures, Brandon. Let me describe these pictures. Uh-huh. Okay.
Paint us a word picture.
There are five pictures, right? One of them, I think, there's four pictures. There's four pictures because one of them is like a blown-up version of it. So the way that it's like kind of organized, I think, is clockwise is the order that the photos were taken, but I could be wrong. You start out, there's like this little sliver of silver that you can see, right? It's roughly person shaped. It's in the center of the frame, which, you know, the composition of these photos, not great. Not great. Just want to throw that out there. Not taken by a photographer.
Not taken by a photographer.
Absolutely
no rule of thirds.
So can't really tell fucking anything, right? Then the second picture zooms in just a little bit, right? So now the figure takes up the whole frame, right? Well, actually, this is probably a cropped version of it, so it's still pretty fucking far away. But you can start to see like details of like a pair of arms, maybe some hands. It's very like crinkly, the material, right? Then you get like a full body shot where you can basically see it. A lot of it is obscured with darkness, but like, you know, it's very clearly some kind of like metallic material. But then the last photo is where it becomes beautiful. So it looks, you remember, you know, those like, those dryer hoses. It kind of looks like somebody put those dryer hoses on all of their limbs and then wrapped themselves, their torso, in a sheet of tin foil and then put a bucket on their head.
Yeah. It just looks like a guy with a bucket on his head wrapped in Mylar. Like, that's at this point, this is what I kind of thought it was going.
It's... Oh, he took more than four pictures, if I'm looking at these negatives right.
He did take more than four. Yeah. So below those are negatives that were acquired by the Aerial Phenomena Research Organization. And the photos he took, if ignore the left mm-hmm. side of that, and everything to the right is, I believe, his photos.
That's all. I wonder what the things on the left are.
Yeah. I don't recall if I touched on that or not. You may notice a few things about the negatives. There are more than four photos, and a number of them contain pictures of UFOs not previously described by Greenaw. Greenaw was 26 at the time of the incident. The only police officer, full-time, in the area, and the woman who made the call is still unknown. The field where the craft landed was owned by a Mr. Bobby Summerford. Okay. We're going to remember that name. He claimed that he parked 75 feet away from the being in question. One article said he didn't find anything or see a craft. And it was only after he took a gravel road on his way home that he came across the metal man. Another description he gave was, it looked like his head and neck were made together. He was a real bright, something like
what?
Like rubbing mercury on nickel, which I've never done. This is the 70s, honestly, so that's you know,
honestly, I guess a 70s thing. Using like dangerous chemicals... for some fucking reason, that's a very 70s move, right? Like
yeah,
using chemicals that have an effect on your brain chemistry, or not chemicals, metals that have an effect on your brain chemistry is basically the 70s in a nutshell.
This is the time period where you could buy your kid a chemistry kit. Just
yeah, I mean, there was that one that had uranium in it too. I think that's a little earlier. But
yeah, it's like, so we're operating mm-hmm. in this general time period, but just as smooth as glass. Different angles give different lighting. When I saw him standing in the middle of the road, I immediately stopped the car and asked if he was a foreigner, but no sound came out of his mouth.
What?
That wouldn't be my first question.
What? Okay.
Although that that reminds me of, so the scene in the early in The Fifth Element, when the Mandashawa come out, and that priest sees them, and he's like, are you German?
Yeah.
But they're like clearly big metal aliens.
Okay, so I want to take a second. There's a few things I want to talk about here.
Yeah.
Arkansas.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yes.
What is his definition of foreigner? Because Arkansas shares no borders with anything other than United States, right? Like, you got Missouri in the north, Louisiana in the south, I think Mississippi somewhere in that mix, maybe Texas a little bit, right? So, like, what?
Uh-huh.
Why is "are you a foreigner" the first question?
I don't know. Like, it's why, I don't. Unless you meant, I don't know.
What does that achieve? Right? Like I'm just struggling to understand why someone would ask that question in the first place.
Well, it's a very small town, and maybe he never left, so
maybe
he's like,
I guess this is what people look like out Canadians. There. I mean, I have no evidence to support or disclaim this. That's just what he thought. That's the reason for his xenophobia.
I mean, there is something to, like, get out there and meet other types of people. I mean, there's something to it. He ran in a bizarre way.
So did we mention that no sound came out of his mouth? Asked if he was a foreigner, but no sound came out of his mouth. I want to believe while this is happening,
didn't talk.
The dude is like, might be Dutch. I'm flabbergasted, like, why that would be, like, my first guess would not be, oh yeah, this is somebody from a different country, right? My first guess would be, oh, some fucking teenagers are being assholes.
My first guess would be, Dave's drunk with tinfoil again. He ran in a bizarre way. He seemed to have springs in the feet for propulsion. Could cover about 3 meters in every way. He was running faster than any human I ever saw. The images that Greenhide snapped were collected and sent for analysis by Walt MUFON. Andrus, a director of MUFON, the Mutual MUFON. UFO Network.
What a place
to find people with free time.
MUFON. Okay, so I think I've mentioned this. I definitely have mentioned this on the podcast. I'm a researcher, right? I do research stuff. Mm-hmm. Right. I've been trained to do research stuff.
Yeah.
Right. So for those of you who don't know, a PhD is effectively an apprenticeship. Right. It's uh-huh. very different than normal college. Right. You're more or less working under someone else and they teach you how they do research. And then you like that's your training. Right.
Yeah.
Most people don't. Like, anyone can do research, but, like, you have to, I don't want to, like, gate it, but, like, you do actually have to understand how research is done to be, like, good at research, right?
Yeah, so you're saying there's, like, a method in training that you kind of have to learn and follow, and you can't really just, like, buy a membership and then have
pretty much. That's what I'm getting at.
Yeah.
Is... You're not a researcher just because you say you are. And like, also, you're not a researcher just because you look up stuff on Facebook or even the internet. There's a lot that goes into proper research. Like, you're not even busting out of the literature review part of research if you're just doing, like, reading other stuff. So, like, that's a whole thing.
Like, I would never say I'm a researcher.
Honestly, I
look at a lot of stuff for this.
You'd be closer to a journalist. And even then, because
I wouldn't even claim that
set of skills, right?
Yeah, there's a whole lot of its own set of stuff that, yeah. I try to dig for, like, original articles and, like, scanned copies and first-hand accounts, but I don't claim to be any of those things.
You didn't say this joke.
Uh-huh.
And it's a pretty fucking good joke.
Okay.
Brandon here, he ran in a bizarre way sentence. And then in purple letters and parentheses, he has spring-heeled brack. And that might be my single favorite sentence I have seen in a month, at least. Because I fucking love the Brack Show. And for those of you who don't know what the Brack Show is,
so
the Brack Show was from an era of Cartoon Network or Adult Swim, where they didn't have any money. So all the stuff that they used was just like recycled animation from Hanna-Barbera cartoons. So they recycled the villains from Space Ghost. Brack, what's the name of, why can't I remember his name?
I can't remember. Yes. I love Space Ghost Coast to Coast too.
But it's
fantastic.
It's a
show.
Phenomenal show. The father is one of the funniest, like, single funniest characters ever. It's just such a funny fucking show. Right. If you have never seen it, please watch it. I honestly, though, I am not sure if it has any like problematic stuff. Zorak, that was the name. Yep.
Zorak.
It's such a wonderful show in my memory. I have no idea if it holds up, like, whatsoever.
Same. I loved it. I have no idea, and I've not gone back and watched any of it. A great, great show. Some ufologists believe that the Metal Man was a robotic scout for an extraterrestrial landing craft. MUFON concluded that this was a hoax. Here's what information I was able to get from a write-up. Information coming from.
So I want to take a second
at Falkville.
If MUFON calls you a hoax, You're a fucking hoax.
Oh, yeah. If like, they rule it out, it's ruled out.
Like,
yeah.
they MUFON wants to believe everything. They're like, they're ready to believe anything is a UFO. But if MUFON says, no, this isn't a UFO, this is a fucking hoax, you have fucked up in your hoaxing.
Oh, very hard. And a photo analysis articles by Coleman von Kvetsky from Official UFO Magazine, Volume 1, Number 2, August 1975. Excerpts from articles in UFO Magazine 1, Number 4, November 1975, and 2, 1973 Alabama newspaper articles.
This appeared in the fourth episode, the fourth issue of Official UFO Magazine, because that's what that means. Volume 1, issue number 4. This is the fourth, like, total paper of this, like issue of this magazine that maybe still exists, probably doesn't.
I don't know if that still exists. And the newspaper articles were from Coleman von Kvetsky, director of the Intercontinental UFO Galactic Spacecraft Research and Analytic Network, or ICUFON, ICUFON. I'm gonna omit all information that we already covered because they did. We got some of it already.
I'm just
time and location. Yeah,
that name. What the fuck? No.
Coleman
International
von
UFO
Kvetsky?
Galactic Spacecraft Research and Analytic Network. Why? Also, I want to point out their acronym is bad. ICUFON? Like, okay,
oh, yeah,
so it's Intercontinental,
no,
so IC, UFO Network. Okay, Intercontinental UFO Network. That's what their acronym is.
Yeah, they left out Galactic Spacecraft Research.
They left out
and
all of that
network.
Part in their fucking UFO people. Fucking UFO people.
It gets worse. October 17, 1973, between 10:30 and 11 p.m. local time, west of Falkville, Morgan County, state of Alabama, USA, four Polaroid photographs, again, there's more than four, of a human-like creature were unidentifiable as earthly origin. Wanted subject has never been found since
County.
By state and country police
so,
stations.
So, Polaroids, correct me if I'm wrong, Polaroids don't fucking have negatives.
Yeah, they're on rolls of film.
Was Polaroid making a non-instant camera at this time?
Polaroid, they may have been, or it may have been a... I don't know what the word is for this, but when like people
it's
say
a,
Kleenex
it's a
instead
generic
of tissue or
whatever.
Coke instead of soda.
Yeah.
It may have been something similar to that. This is interesting because the time of night when weather reports show the night sky, it was clear and the moon was
so
bright.
So it should have been very easy to see anything.
Camera was... Yeah. And the camera was a Polaroid color pack number 2, size 107, black and white, color 108. Copy negatives of the original photographs, reports, correspondence, and documentation are filed at ICUFONDUIST.
I'm curious what DUIST stands for, because like that's probably that there's probably a fucking lot of words that are omitted in there. I could buy one for $12, one of those cameras.
I'm sure it's wild.
I do want to take a second. I'm looking at a picture of a color pack 2. It is not an instant camera.
Yes.
So there is. Yeah.
Is okay. So they have rolls of negatives. Okay. Yeah. That's good. I'm actually very happy they gave the model information of the camera, in that. So from the interview, I'd heard of previous reports of UFOs from state and county patrol units. I had been laughing at the matter.
It is an instant. This is the develop. Hold handle, let camera hang, don't hold camera body. Pull white tab all the way out of camera, yellow tab pops out. Pull yellow tab all the way out of camera. Pull straight, medium, fast without stopping, begin timing development. Wait for the full time given in the instructions. Separate picture from yellow tab. Put into waste basket. Please put into waste tab into waste basket. So there, it is an instant camera. So then, what the fuck? What the fuck? Where the fuck did they have negatives?
Those are the pictures. This
camera is literally just a box. I want to point out.
Unless he just provided a different camera that he had.
Old cameras are wild because they're literally just since boxes.
Oh yeah. Well, that's what the Instagram thing is.
Well, yeah.
Just old timey camera.
I'm more talking about the fact that like it's just like a lens and then a box because it's doing like pinhole projection or whatever. It's projecting the light. Yeah, it's just wild to me that that's just how they work.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the advancement between old shit, really old shit, and that shit is like they moved the chemical process inside the box. Like there's advancements in the development of the image itself, which is wild. Since I hadn't heard of UFOs, I had been carrying a Polaroid with me. I don't know what I ran upon or see that would be of interest to me in my work. Here's a photo of 23 or 24-year-old Greenoff 7 months after the incident. The scene showing his relative position to the
creature. I'm assuming it's like the black
different
X
newspapers
the,
report him
where the creature
as 23 or 26 at the time.
This dude looks old, old 26. Like it looks like he's lived some time, like. He doesn't.
I was just about to say.
Yeah,
he does
he
not
looks
look
like
26.
He had a rough
he's 26 going on 53. Yeah, and he appears to be about 15 feet away
he's
rather
like,
than 75 feet away. Which makes sense given how the images look. And he said after a half mile chase, the creature disappeared here on the road. Without having
it's
said
funny
which
that
direction
he points
the creature
both
actually went. Greenhawk.
He's like, I don't know.
And, like, he's literally pointing both directions. And it's like, you were there and took pictures. Did it go which way? Greenock called the incident into the newspaper at 11:30 p.m.
This is a bullshit story. Because the event happened at 10 o'clock. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Like an hour later, he's on the horn with the newspaper.
Questionable.
Yeah. There were also a series of incidents that occurred following the encounter. Number one was around October 19th, 1973, a campaign of harassment was launched against Greenaw with threatening phone calls and hate letters of accusing him of being a mental case, idiot, crackpot, faker, devil, and so on. In October 21st,
what?
2 days later, his car's engine blew up. on October 24th, the harassment having completely disrupted his whole family, his wife left home and forced him to consent to divorce on October 29th.
Jesus
so
Christ.
So all of this within seven days. I suspect there was a lot more going on for her to have gotten fed up with his shit.
Like, the things happening. Yeah. Or she knew that he was
UFOs.
Lying. Right?
Yeah.
And he was like... She was like, I'm fucking done with your shit. You're responsible for all of the dumb shit that's happening to us right now. You are 100% responsible. I'm leaving. Fucking fuck you.
Yeah. Number four, on October 9th, his trailer home burned down and was totally demolished. And there's an image of him standing in front of the burnt out husk of his trailer. And action number five, on November 14th, a final reminder, his obituary was placed on his car's windshield, which...
Man,
that's fucking
small
aggressive.
Town folks go hard.
Yep. And lastly, number six, on November 15th, the town council called in Greenaw and forced him to resign. The town council, of course, denied that his resignation had anything to do with the series of incidents that Greenob was involved with.
I honestly or the pictures would taken not be of the surprised creature. If he was not, like, doing other shit that was bad. Like...
That, yeah. Like, and that, oof, like, there's a lot that happened.
This seems like a disproportionate response to saying I saw a UFO, right? Like, I know that UFO people, there's some UFO people who'll be like, no, this happens all the time. But, like, realistically speaking, like, it's usually not, like, this aggressive, right? Like, this is a super aggressive response. Yeah. So, like, I don't know. This one feels a little bit like, dude was doing bad shit beforehand. Or was, like, not liked beforehand, and then this was just, like, the straw that broke the camel's back for him, for them.
Oh, very much so. So here's what I was able to find doing some research online and using some people's names from articles as keywords. The incident was only 6 days after a much more popular UFO encounter in Pascagoula, Mississippi. This leads me to believe that if this was a hoax, it would have been the only full-time officer trying to cash in on the trend. So, like, I think he might have heard about that and tried to, like,
I want to point out that
stuff.
Our episode on the Pascagoula alien abduction, which was the Elephant Men, that is episode 60 of this podcast, 62 of this podcast. If you want to know,
go check it out. We keep a spreadsheet for a reason. Okay, that works too. The creature in question bears a striking resemblance to an asbestos fire suit, and I've got some images down below.
That kind of looks strikingly
similar, huh?
Like,
but where, John? Would a lone officer get one suit that looks identical to the images from before? Surely if he had borrowed one from the fire department, someone might say something. But that's when I came upon Bobby Summerford's obituary. Yep. Bobby was the owner of the field that the spaceman was seen in. And Bobby was also the owner of Summerford General Mercantile. It's possible that hearing about the Pascagoula incident, Police Chief Bobby contacted the owner of Summerford Mercantile to acquire an asbestos fire suit and took some grainy photos in his field, trying to cash in on some media hype.
I
strongly suspect that's what happened.
Well, because also he runs the General Mercantile, right? So, historically speaking, these types of things in, like, the 60s and 70s led to booms in towns of, like, people visiting. So there is a motivation there for him to do this because he wants people to show up and, like, look into it.
Yeah. I don't even remember this. Okay. So this is something, I wrote this so long ago. I wrote, oop, writing this live. I found by a post on someone who lives in Falkville that did some asking around. And they wrote, I work in Falkville. I lived there on my own for a year and went to school there from 2004 to 2007. And this is literally the first time I've ever heard of this. Looks like I'm going to ask around work and see if any of the older guys know anything about it. Then they posted an update. I asked around at work and only two people knew what I was talking about. First guy's old enough to have remembered seeing it in the newspaper. The second guy gave me a pretty interesting answer. He says he knows the guy who had the suit on. He wouldn't tell me who it was because the guy told him to wait until he died first because the mentioned police chief, Jeff Greenhaw, ruined his own life over it because it got to him so bad. So all in all, it was a prank that actually ended up costing someone their life and sanity. And then they say, okay, for those who wanted to know, I updated my first comment, but now I will further update it. Turns out another guy at work knows the guy who wore the suit, too. It was a guy named Ricky Joe Smith or Schmidt.
Ricky Joe didn't have time to get the actual last name. Like, middle of nowhere name.
We got a picture of Ricky Joe Smith in a asbestos fire suit. Once he started talking about it, that guy, almost everyone I asked immediately knew who he was talking about. So the legend of the Metal Man has been debunked. And the comment was from user Valkyrie Valor.
Oh, no.
Someone else wrote, "This is correct. My family has lived here for generations. That's the story. Ricky Joe Smith used to be the fire chief in Hartsville. So it was the fire chief, Ricky Joe, in his own asbestos spacesuit being photographed by...
You know what the real real paranormal event was? The police and the fire department getting along. Am I
What's
right?
That? Hey... and Hartsville is 5 miles
Jesus
away from Falkville.
Christ.
So they would have been very close and probably knew each other and hung out at the same bar. So there we have it. Coincidental information would suggest that Police Chief Greenaw took photos of Fire Chief Ricky Joe Smith in Bobby Summerford's field 6 days later, or sorry, 6 days after a UFO sighting in Mississippi.
Oh my god, it's so like,
I love it.
It's so dumb. It reminds me of Glass Onion, right? Where it's like, have you seen Glass Onion yet? Oh, you have to see it. Knives Out, Glass Onion. It's really,
I have not.
Good. I'm not going to say anything more then.
Is it good?
But like, there's a scene where Daniel Craig is just like, it's stupid. And that's how I feel about this plot. It's just stupid.
It's
also
good.
Getting to the point.
It's
it also
stupid.
Gets to the point that like in a small town, everyone knows when you're being a dumbass. Like everyone knows who's being a dumbass and what they're doing, right? There's no like, You don't...
Yeah.
You're not
yeah.
able to hide the fact that you're an idiot in a small town. Everyone knows you're an idiot.
Everyone knows, and everyone... It's so funny, because everyone knew everybody that was involved with this. And clearly, Greenaw's wife had some other issues
also,
with their relationship.
Even where we went to school, it wasn't as small as this town, but like... Everyone knew fucking everyone at our school, and it was like a
oh, yeah.
bigger place.
Yeah, everyone knew everyone. Like, there were no secrets, because everybody, it was...
Not even.
What was our class?
Like
200 people? Yeah, like, it's... And even with that, like, ugh.
Everyone knew who shoved small. Vegetables up inside themselves, or, you know... Uh-huh.
Or did what in what room? Actually, if I recall correctly, our class was the largest class our high school had ever seen,
our
and it was only like 140 people.
Had a bunch of people who like didn't advance, right? Like, I remember one time I was talking to somebody
yeah.
who was younger than us.
Super seniors.
Yeah, super seniors. I was talking to someone who was younger than us, and they were like, our grade has to be like the dumbest, and then they named a few people. I'm like, you do realize that, like, those people that you just named are from our grade. They just got held back, right?
Yeah.
Like,
there's, well, we had, I don't recall the individual's name who did this, but we had someone who, like, we played frisbee at school and wall ball and stuff would go up on the roof, mm-hmm. and someone jumped off the roof and broke both their ankles. We also had someone who shot their own eye out because they took a shotgun shell and put it on a vice, like a vice grip, a bench mount one, and hit
oh,
it with
I don't
a hammer.
Remember that. I don't remember that.
We had another person who went inside of a, not a treehouse, but like a fort built out of wood that was on the ground and lit it on fire, but it wasn't going fast enough, so they burnt their entire body because they went inside and started spraying lighter fluid and it traveled up the stream. So they got covered in burns with that.
What?
We had a lot of ill-advised. I played shovel pogo. I mean, like, there was a lot of, like...
Shovel... Oh, wait. Shovel pogo was on the concrete, wasn't it?
Yeah, shovel pogo is when you go to a hardware store that has a lifetime warranty on their shovels, and then you jump on it like a pogo stick on concrete to cause the blade to fold a little bit and then snap back, and whoever does that the most wins. There was the ladder game where you just stand a ladder up, not leaning against anything, and whoever can climb it the highest before it falls over wins that game. There was a lot of like rural shenanigans.
What we're trying to say is when people don't have access to certain things, they do dumb shit.
Yeah, you make your own fun, and half the time it's dangerous and dumb.
I was just like a relentless video game player. Like, that was it. That was all I did.
There's also lots of video games. Lots and lots of video games. Do you like cheese, motherfucker? Video games.
Do you like cheese, motherfucker? Metabolic.
Do you? Oh, Metabolic. Rip Metabolic. He's still alive, probably, but
probably Metabolic. He was younger than us.
Yeah.
God, that was a fucking fever dream. Those years. Fucking Xbox Live, Halo 2 Xbox Live is a time period, is like a period of time that will never get back. It's just gone, right? There's nothing that could ever even remotely be quite like that, right? Because, like, there's so much more interconnectedness now in everything.
Oh, yeah.
So, that time period, you had AIM.
Oh, yeah.
And Halo. And Xbox Live. And if you had Xbox Live, you better have the same game. Because that was it. That was everything, right?
Yeah.
That was the only way to hang out with people when you weren't, like, there.
And AIM, because this is a thing that we probably have to explain, is AOL Instant Message.
Yeah, that's probably true. And I don't like the fact we have to explain that. I gotta say, I'm so glad that my AOL, my AOL account from that time period, I can't access it anymore.
Yeah. Because, and then I had Pigeon. And if I recall correctly, Pigeon was an instant messaging service, so you could DM your friends, but it could go across multiple different, so you could have a friend that had AIM and a friend that had something else,
like
and still talk to them.
Hotmail, like, yeah. Instant Messenger or whatever. Yeah. Because that was also a thing. I think if my memory is correct, it was called Pigeon because of, like, the language.
Oh, I thought it was Pigeon, like Messenger Pigeon. If the language went into that, then that's a perfect name because those two things coincide nicely.
More than 78 million. I think it was like a combination of like Pigeon and Pigeon, right? Like, I think it was a double because it was spelt Pigeon, like the language.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't know. I used that after a while.
But what I was trying to say in regards to like my old AIM, my old AOL account, I'm so glad, so fucking glad that I don't have access to that, because the things that I, the messages
oh,
that
the
I
things
wrote
that I sent and received
from that time
Lord.
Period, I never, 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 never in a million years want to see it again.
No, I'm glad that portion is gone forever.
There were some, apparently Mike, our one mutual friend, whose name I said, but you don't know his last name, so whatever. He has access to his old AIM logs.
Why?
I don't know, but like he told me that it was some of the worst, like cringiest shit he's ever read.
That's fair. Jesus.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, it's a nightmare. So yeah, you know what? I actually feel bad for like kids nowadays and like teens nowadays, because it's so much easier to keep a record of everything, every stupid thing that you're doing, than it was when we were younger. And like it was starting to get easy to keep a record of the stupid shit you were doing, right? Because like junior year, I want to say, Facebook became a thing for us, roughly. Right, it was either junior or
about
sophomore.
That, yeah,
and like before that, it was MySpace.
The MySpace transition,
but MySpace was like really just literally a page, right? Like there wasn't much. It was less like sharing content and more like this is shit that I like. Like I mean, I had a fucking bunch of Naruto pictures on my MySpace.
The thing that I loved about MySpace is, like, with Facebook, you don't have to learn HTML.
To be fair,
that was, like, half the fun of MySpace.
To be fair, you didn't have to learn HTML for MySpace, but, like, if you wanted a MySpace that was, like, actually good, you did.
Yeah, if you wanted to make it the most rad, which meant everyone hates it except you, mm-hmm. you had to know HTML.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's basically the... Also, I vaguely remember people, like, when it came to MySpace, if my memory is correct, I could be wrong... If somebody was fucking with your MySpace, right? They could do way more shit to you than if they were fucking with, like, any of your other social media. I vaguely remember that happening.
Yeah. The good news is because I forget why, at some point I wanted to see my old MySpace just to see, like,
oh, the purge.
Oh, see what I had done at the time. It's been purged. It's gone. It's gone. It's gone. It's gone. And that's a good thing.
Yep. You know what else? You know what's actually bad about that, though? There's a fuck ton of music now that's just lost media because of that.
Oh, that's true.
Because, like, MySpace had so much shit. Yeah,
all the high school bands.
Yeah. So, like,
all uploaded to MySpace.
Yeah. There's, like, a fuck ton of lost media now because of that. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Anywho. This has been us being...
Happy St. Patrick's.
Yeah, happy St. Patrick's Day.
Old?
Yeah.
Happy St. Patrick's Day. Woo!
What are we doing here? We
St. Patrick's Day facts? There were no snakes to begin with. They killed all the pagans.
Yeah. Yeah.
Listen to IRA songs because it's like... folk music that goes hard and it's very, like, funny.
God damn it.
I posted one to the Discord of, like, a grandmother. There's just a folk song about a grandma whacking an English soldier with a garbage can, and that's the whole song, and it's great.
That sounds very Irish.
Yeah.
All right, and everyone, of course, will be a... everyone in America who is white will be an Irish-American on Friday. Remember that? Remember that? You get one day.
You get one... Yeah, yeah.
After that, stop. I'll give you that one day, but after that, fucking stop.
You get one day to claim an entire culture and heritage to be your mm-hmm. own that has a very long and distraught history, and that's not weird.
Irish history is like... It's so... Okay, Irish history is weird because, like... for a very long time, like, before, like, colorism was a thing, Irish people weren't considered white, which is...
Yeah, Irish people weren't considered white, and then, like, oh, and they're dancing? So the dance isn't a fun dance. It's because they were being forced to dance for the crown, and they're like, well, fuck you, we're not gonna dance, we'll just wiggle our feet to, like... technically dance, and that's why there's that dance where, like, they don't move the upper part of their body at all, is kind of like a fuck you to the crown.
Jesus Christ. Also, there's a lot of stuff you can look into regarding the Catholic Church in Ireland. I'll just leave that on the table. Also, Hasbro in Ireland. Look that up.
Oh, God. Yeah, oh,
have
God.
Have fun with that.
That lives in the Actually Cursed channel.
Yeah, that is... What was it?
Actually Cursed.
I think it was Unwed Mothers. No, Children. I think it was child labor that they used to make, like, Mousetrap. Like, assemble Mousetrap board games, if my memory is correct. So, yeah, have fun.
Yeah.
Anywho, this has been Cryptopedia. The website is cryptopediacast.com. Our Instagram is @cryptopediacast. So is our Twitter. If you want to email us, cryptopediacast@gmail.com or us @cryptopediacast.com. We have a YouTube @cryptopedia, which has machine transcription, if that's your thing. We also have a Patreon. And Brandon, will you give our jackalopes a thank you?
Indeed. Did I not include the jackalopes on this?
They're here.
Oh, I have to scroll up. Sorry. Yeah, so thank you to our jackalopes, Clay Sinclair, Marty Von Party, Bird Schneider, Lenwood Sharp, Matthew Smith, Bushcraft Kelso, and Will Smith.
Okay, we have a Discord. That's where we do stuff now. If you have any monster requests or stories, probably post it there, because, like, that's where we do stuff.
That's where we live.
Yeah. If you enjoyed the podcast, be sure to rate, subscribe, all that stuff.
You could find me on Instagram at donkey_hands. My website is boyerb.com. My email is brandon@cryptopediacast.com. And my Twitter is @cryptobrandon.
I'm on Instagram at mew2057. My Twitter is @jfdunham. My website is johndunhamgames.com. And my email is john@cryptopediacast.com.
Our art was done by Tom Hill. You could find him on Instagram at Thomas Michael Hill. His website is greatergloryco.com, and his email is tommikehill@gmail.com.
I want to take a second, Brandon, because you said Jeg, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
So I just scrolled to the bottom of this thing, and you misspelled,
you know,
Jeff as Jeg, because it was Jeff.
F and G are right there on the right there on the keyboard. It's an easy mistake to make.
His name is Jeff. His name's not Jeg. We spent like 5 minutes making Jeg jokes. Brandon. Oh God. Anywho, I'm John.
I'm Brandon.
And things are gonna get Jeg.
Hey, Edit Bay Brandon here. So with our tech issue, we lost sync, so we killed our video. But that means we also lost our video, so we couldn't pick up on physical cues. And we still had some more audio drifting, tech issues, etc. What that all means is that I went in, I did some realignment and cutting in that. But if we spoke over each other a little bit more than normal, that's what that is. Sorry. We love you. Mwah. Cue the second tone.